Good evening, students. Today we will start one more biology topic for our bridge course, our environment. Students, this is the last topic and a very important topic for your entrance exam point of view. So you need to concentrate on this topic also, along with other topics like reproduction, genetics and evolution, all those. This is also one of the very, very important topic. So what we are going to learn in this topic called as our environment. Here we are going to come study the ecosystem. Then components of ecosystem. Then here we have a biotic and abiotic components. Biotic and abiotic components. Then afterwards we are going to perform an activity. Then we are going to learn about food chain. Then food web. Along with the flow of energy. These many concepts you are going to study in our today's class. Now, what is this ecosystem? First of all, we should know about our ecology. Ecology is a study of interaction among the living organisms and interaction of these living organisms with the surrounding environment is called as a ecology. So study of ecology is very, very important. We are dealing with whatever the reactions that occurs in our environment in this ecology. So in that we have a system called as a ecosystem. In ecosystem also we are going to study the interaction among the living and non-living components. Here, both living and non-living components are interacting with each other, both are depends on each other. Usually, our living organisms are depending on the non-living things called as abiotic factors. That study of interaction among the living and non-living components is called as ecosystem. It is the branch of biology. Branch of biology deals with study of interaction among living and non-living components. How they depends on each other, how they're depending on the what you call as opposite components. Living components depends on the non-living, and non-living components are formed by the living components. So here, what are the living components, components of ecosystem? Next, we have components of ecosystem. Components of ecosystems. Here, we classified these components into two types. Living components, also called as biotic components. What are these living components or biotic components? In our nature, we have a diversity of organisms called as a biodiversity. It is the sum total of all living forms. there are large number of microbes, large number of plants, large number of animals, all together called as biotic components or living components. And all these depends on each other. Here we have green plants. So plants are there. So these plants gives food for the animals. So animals are depends on the plants. And both plants and animals are decomposed by the decomposers. Decomposers. So these three are the living components of our ecosystem. Plants, animals and decomposers. All three are the living components of our ecosystem. Then what is the role of these plants in our ecosystem? Plants are able to harvest the solar energy and prepare the food in the form of glucose. These trap about 1% of this solar energy, and that energy which is trapped by the plants is called as a PAR, photosynthetically active radiations. These radiations are trapped by the plants, and plants by their own mechanism called as a photosynthesis, they prepare the food in the form of glucose, and that glucose get a store into the plant's body in the form of a starch, which is further used by the same plant, or it may be used by the dependent animals. Then what is the role of animals in this ecosystem? So ecosystems, these animals feed on the plants and proceed or continue the food chain. Continuation of food chain is not important, but also animals involve into seed dispersal, involve into pollination of a plant, involve into maintaining a biodiversity in our ecosystem. So as plants are important, our animals are also equally important in our ecosystem. Then see our decomposers. So these decomposers are the microbes like bacteria and fungi. Imagine the world without decomposers. You know, our dead bodies of plants or animals or any other small invertebrates, all are decomposed, and these are again mineralized with the help of the decomposers like microbes, like bacteria and fungi. If these decomposers are not there, all the dead bodies cannot be decomposed. All the plants will remain as it is. All the dead animals will remain as it is. So there's no any other ways to remove the waste in our nature without the decomposers. So out of these three living components of our ecosystem, decomposers are very, very important. So these clean our nature. These are involved into mineralization of the organic molecules. So that is the process called as a decomposition with help of the decomposers. So these three are the living components in our ecosystem. And living components of different ecosystems varies. Not all the plants or all kinds of plants are present in all the habitats, all the ecosystems. See here, for example, we have a grassland ecosystem. We have a grassland ecosystem. In a grassland ecosystem, here small grasses. Grasses are the producers or plants. Here we find some grasshoppers. Then frogs, snakes, hawk. These are the organisms or components or living components of the grassland ecosystem. Say for example, it is a aquatic ecosystem. If it is a aquatic ecosystem, again, these living components will be different. In aquatic ecosystem, we find rooted submerged plants. Floating plants. floating plants rooted plants like that, different types of the plants again, planktons, these are the producers in our aquatic ecosystem. So the grasses are there in grassland, but all these kinds of plants are found in the aquatic ecosystem, and depending animals on this are the fishes, zooplanktons, then here also we find some aquatic frogs, we find kingfisher bird, like this some aquatic animals are found in the aquatic ecosystem. And if it is a forest ecosystem, if it is a forest ecosystem, if it is a forest ecosystem, we find different kinds of animals. And plants. In the forest, we find larger trees, shrubs, herbs, these are the plants found in the forest. Here larger trees will form a canopy, their height may be about 20 meters to 135 meters. And all these will form a thick cavity in the forest ecosystem. And below that, we find some shrubs and very small plants called as herbs. And in this forest, we find all kinds of animals like herbivorous animals. Carnivorous animals. So different kinds of animals we find in a forest ecosystem. So while discussing all this, we are having a different or enormous different types of the ecosystems in our nature. So grassland ecosystem, aquatic ecosystems, forest ecosystem, desert ecosystem, ocean ecosystem, again there are some man-made ecosystems we list afterwards. So we find different kinds of ecosystem, but the living components found in different kinds of ecosystems varies. We cannot find all kinds of plants in all ecosystems. They are differ from ecosystem to ecosystem. Also, animals also differ from the ecosystem to ecosystem. Now, in next class, we discuss what are the non-living components of an ecosystem. Non-living components of ecosystem, which are the non-living here and very much essential for the our nutrient cycling and all our living components, which are depend on these non-living components. These are the first one: temperature, second one, water, third one, solar energy in the form of light, fourth one, soil. These are the major abiotic factors through which our biotic factors or living factors will interact in our daily life. Temperature. What is the role of temperature? Temperature will give us activity for the organisms. Here our plants or animals will depends on temperature for their activity of enzymes. Enzymes are active at a particular temperature in the plants as well as enzymes, as well as animals. So, we can say temperature is very much essential for the activity of enzymes. Other than this, temperature will maintain the what we call as a body in our optimal condition. Without a temperature, our other body organs are not working. So, in plants also temperature is very, very important. So, in plants like there are some enzymes like Rubisco, Pepcase enzymes. So, these are active at a certain temperature only. So, some animals are dependent on the temperature. Some animals will survive in a very low temperature and some animals will survive in high temperatures. Those animals which survive in a low temperature, they are called as a wide range of temperature, they are called as a stenothermal animals. Stenothermal organisms are stenothermal animals. These survive in a what you call as a low temperature. Then one more temperature called as organisms called as a urethermal organisms. The organisms which survive in a high temperature, here also their enzymes are active at a high temperature. That is, they are able to survive in a high temperature. Urethermal organisms, stenothermal, urethermal are the two kinds of animals or plants are found in our nature, and this depends on varied kind of temperature. Then water. Water is very much essential for our daily life. Plants also require water for various purposes. Water in the plants is absorbed by the roots and carried towards the aerial parts. So, water maintains the turgidity of our cells. Water involved in the transpiration pull, and water activates the enzymes, and water mainly involved into required for the photosynthesis in the plants. So, this is water. So, in animals also, water required for the thermoregulation, osmoregulation, maintenance of a constant temperature, maintenance of a constant osmotic fluid in cells of our animals also, the requirement of water. In plants also, water meant for the keeping the cells turgid or photosynthesis or transpiration pool that carry the minerals towards the aerial parts. Like that, so many important works are done by the water in the plants. So, plants depends on this water also. Apart from all this, we have a solar energy. Solar energy, nothing but sunlight. This sunlight or solar energy. It is very much essential for the plants, as plants are able to harvest light, they will harvest visible light. In that visible light, they will absorb the red and blue light and increase the rate of photosynthesis. So, light not only required for the photosynthesis, through the light, our plants will proceed phototropism, photoperiodism, and photosynthesis. Here, by using the sunlight, plants proceed photosynthesis. Then phototropism, then photoperiodism, photosynthesis, synthesis of food in the form of glucose is a photosynthesis. Phototropism, movement of the tip of the shoot towards the light is called as a phototropism, and photoperiodism, movement, it is a induction of flowers in the plant due to the exposure to the light. When plants are exposed to different duration of light, plants will produce the flowers and fruits and set the seeds. So, this is called as a photoperiodism. So, these are the various aspects in the plants. Animals also depending on the light for their foraging activity, means capturing their prey or hunting their prey, and reproduction. Like that, different activities are based on the duration and intensity of light in animals also. So both plants and animals depends on the light. Then soil, you know, the soil is a reservoir of all the mineral elements. Soil is one more abiotic factor. So this is a reservoir of all the mineral elements. There are so many, about more than 17 essential elements in the soil. Out of these 17 essential elements for the plants, 14 are present in their ionic form in the soil. So soil is rich in inorganic salts. Soil is rich in inorganic salts. Nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus, ferrous, boron, nickel, chlorine, manganese, molybdenum, magnesium, calcium, then copper, iron, all these are the inorganic elements or inorganic salts present in soil in a large concentration. So also rich in organic matter, rich in organic matter, which is formed by the dead and decay of the large number of plants and large number of animals. So soil is also rich in microflora. It harbors a large number of the microorganisms, microflora, large number of microorganisms which are able to fix the nitrogen, which are able to proceed a nitrification process like that. So many kinds of bacteria or fungi are present inside the soil. Soil have a water holding capacity. Water holding capacity. Soil have water holding capacity. Soil have percolation, water percolation capacity. So water gets percolates inside the soil also. So these are the various components found in a soil. So these components will attract a large number of plants, that is called as a flora of our ecosystem, and dependent fauna, dependent animals also will attracted by this soil, because soil is rich in inorganic salts, organic matter, microflora, water holding capacity, and soil also having a water percolation capacity. Because of these reasons, soil will decide the flora, and based on the flora, there is an attractant of fauna, means animals also. So ecosystem is fulfilled by the all kinds of four non-living components of our ecosystem. So there are temperature, water, sunlight, and soil. Next, we can discuss what are the role of living components in our ecosystem. As you know, we have plants. We have plants. What is the role of these plants in our ecosystem? What is the role of plants in the ecosystem? So plants are very much essential for the animals, as animals depending on the plants for two products. One is food, and one more is oxygen. So plants act as a producers. Plant act as a producers in our ecosystem. Plants act as a producers. These are kept in tropic levels. So here, these occupy the first tropic level. Plants occupy the first tropic level. Plants occupy the first tropic level, and plants are called as producers, as these prepare their own food. And as you know, the plants are the autotrophs. They are able to harvest light. They absorb about 1% of the total solar energy, and through that energy or through that light, they prepare the food in the form of glucose. And these act as producers in our ecosystem, If you are observing the trophic levels, these occupy the first trophic levels in our ecosystem. Then there are animals. There are animals. What is the role of these animals? So, animals in our ecosystem are the consumers. These are heterotrophic organisms. Animals are heterotrophic organisms. So, these animals depend on the plants for the food as well as oxygen. Some animals depend on the food directly, and some animals depend on this food indirectly on the plant. You know, the lion, tiger, and this leopard, these are not going to have grasses and any of the plant products. These are not herbivorous, but these also depend on the plants indirectly. So, these feed on the other animals which feed on the plants. So, these carnivorous are consumers are going to classify into herbivores and carnivores. What are these herbivores? As the name indicates, herbivores are the animals which directly depends on the plants for their food. So, these will feed on the various parts of the plant or products of the plants. Animals like elephant, goat, buffalo, cow, ox, sheep, deer. These are the animals. So, these animals are called as herbivorous animals. These directly feed on the plants. And animals of a different ecosystem are different only. Elephants are not found in a grassland. Elephants are not found in an aquatic ecosystem. But goats, and sheep and deers can be survive in grasslands, and this buffalo and cow are going to survive in our domestic areas. So, depends on the ecosystem, we have different kinds of herbivorous animals. So, dependent animals on the herbivorous are the carnivorous animals, the animals which depends on the herbivorous animals. Animals which feed on the flesh of the herbivorous animals are called as carnivores. In carnivores, there are two types. There are two types of the carnivores. First type is a primary carnivores, which are directly depends on the herbivorous animals. These are the small carnivorous animals. And other animals are the top carnivores. The animals which feed on the primary carnivores are called as top carnivorous animals. Lion, tiger, or you can say human beings also, top carnivorous animals. And if you are observing the tropic levels of these animals, in animals we find herbivores, primary carnivores and top carnivores. So, in consumers, we have different trophic levels. Consumers again occupy the second trophic level. So, these are the primary consumers. Nothing but herbivores. Primary consumers, nothing but herbivores. And there are secondary consumers, means they occupy third trophic level. Remember all this properly. third trophic level. The animals which occupy the third trophic level, and these are the secondary consumers are nothing but primary carnivores. So these secondary consumers depends on the herbivorous animals. So these are not feeding on the plants directly, they feeding on the flesh of the herbivorous animals are called as secondary consumers. Here you find some carnivorous animals like primary carnivorous animals, species for primary carnivorous animals. And next tropic level is fourth tropic level occupied by the tertiary carnivorous animals. These are the called as the top carnivorous animals or secondary carnivorous animals. Here third tropic level but secondary consumers, fourth tropic level but tertiary carnivorous animals. So tertiary we can say consumers, tertiary consumers. Fourth tropic level, tertiary consumers, these are the top carnivorous animals. So first tropic level occupied by the producers. If it is a one pyramid of ecosystem, here producers are the first tropic level organisms. In this first level we find producers. Here they occupy the first tropic level. Then here you find herbivores, they occupy the second tropic level. Then lower consumers are primary carnivores, they occupy the third tropic level. And top carnivorous animals are secondary carnivores occupy the fourth tropic level. So producers first tropic level, herbivorous animals second tropic level, then primary carnivorous animals at third tropic level, secondary or top carnivorous animals occupy the fourth tropic level. So you should remember them properly. Then we have decomposers. Decomposers. So these decomposers are the microorganisms like bacteria and fungi are the decomposers. Usually these decomposers will process called as decomposition. Decomposition is very, very important process in our nature. Without decomposition, there is no space for us to survive in this habitat, because whatever the dead and decayed organisms in the forest, all are decomposed and are mineralized with help of this microbes like bacteria and fungi. So decomposers will proceed a process called as decomposition. For your reference, in a decomposition there are five steps. You are learning this in a PUC level. Fragmentation, leaching, catabolism, humification, humification mineralization. There are the five steps of decomposition. Here our bacteria and fungi, as well as with help of our farmer's friend called as earthworms, all this involved into process of decomposition and convert the organic matter or fragment the organic matter into inorganic salts. This is the role of decomposers. So totally you learned the role of biotic factors in ecosystem and role of abiotic factors in the ecosystem. So your first heading is both biotic and abiotic components. Later on that, where we find this all biotic and abiotic components, what are the components found in one artificial pond or aquarium? If you construct the aquarium, one activity we have here, we have constructed one aquarium, a glass house for the fish. This is one aquarium. So in this you are going to create a such a environment. You are going to fill the water. You are going to fill water in this aquarium. And you brought some fishes and kept in this pond. So this one artificial aquatic ecosystem. Again, you are going to paste some plants. Here we are going to paste the plants. We are going to provide artificial plants here. And throw the one device, you are going to blow the air bubbles. Going to blow the air bubbles. That is the origin of air bubbles. And one light source will be there at one more side. A light source. You are supplying everything. Now you identify which are the living things and which are the non-living things in this man-made or artificial aquarium or ecosystem. See here, is the plants are living one and these fishes are living one. You are providing air bubbles is a non-living component. Providing water is a non-living component. And providing a source of light is a non-living component. So both these living and non-living components will interact each other. Water having a dissolved oxygen, that oxygen is consumed by the fishes, and fishes will be feeding with artificial what you call as a food. You are going to add some artificial food molecules here. You are going to add a artificial food through the one opening of this aquarium. So here you are going to allow them to interact each other. In the same kind of this pond, you are going to add the different consumers. You are going to add the different consumers is one more activity. What you are doing here, you've grown some phytoplanktons. These are the phytoplanktons. They are floating on the surface of water. Phytoplanktons. And there are some rooted submerged plants. There are some free floating plants like hydrilla. Free floating plants like hydrilla. And some rooted but floating plants. We have here a lotus. A lotus plant. You took a same aquarium. It may be bigger than previous one. In this aquarium, you poured water. And you are going to add some animals. I am not sure they are all fishes. They are different kinds of consumers. Here we have some fishes. Some fishes are there here. And we have one frog also. A frog. Looking like a frog. Then here we have some zooplanktons. There are some zooplanktons floating on the surface of water. Also, you added some zooplanktons. You also added some larger fishes. Larger fishes. And there is one a bird called as a kingfisher sitting on surface of this water. So, in this ecosystem, you added the plants as well as the different kinds of animals. So, in previous ecosystem, there were only single consumers. The species of the fishes were there. They are not going to interact and they are not going to depend on each other. It depends on the artificial food. It depends on what? Artificial food. But here there are different kinds of aquatic organisms. Here you find different kinds of plants. There are rooted submerged plants and free floating submerged plants and rooted free floating plants like that. Different kinds of plants are here along with green colored phytoplanktons. All are the primary producers. They are able to prepare the food by photosynthesis. Then here we kept some zooplanktons, small fishes, large fishes, some frogs are there, and one kingfisher bird also sitting on this water body. So what we can conclude here? Here we can find the interaction among the living organisms. You know, there is a growth of the phytoplanktons. So these phytoplanktons are eaten by the zooplanktons, pink colored zooplanktons. So, these zooplanktons will feed on the, are eaten by the small fishes. Small fishes are eaten by the large fishes. Both small and large fishes are eaten by the bird called as a predatory bird, kingfisher. So, like that we find the interaction among the, what we call as the living components. So, all these living components may be plants or animals, all depend on the presence of water, a source of light and bubbling oxygen bubbles. So, what it concludes, it gives a correct idea about ecosystem, what are the components found in ecosystem. So, everything is visible in one of the classical ecosystem called as the pond ecosystem. So, pond ecosystem is a fundamental ecosystem or a classical ecosystem where you find all kinds of living and non-living components. So, in this activity, we learned that there is a interaction among the living as well as the non-living components. Next, we have a food chain. Food chain. What is food chain? Food chain is a series of or collection of interaction among the organisms. Collection of interactions among the organisms in which organisms eat and being eaten by the other organisms. If one organism eating on the plant and that organism is herbivorous animal and that is eaten by the one more carnivorous animals. Like that in the food chain is a series of interaction among the living components in which one organism will feed on the other organism and again eaten by the one more organism. So food chain is a collection of interaction, collection of interaction among the living components in which one organism eat another but being eaten by one more organism is called a food chain. We have so many food chains in our ecosystem. Very classical and basic example for the food chain is grass is eaten by grasshopper. Is eaten by the frog, and frog is eaten by the hawk. And here we have one more smaller animal, snake. Snake is eaten by the hawk or eagle. So this is a classical example. You will find almost 4 to 5 trophic levels, and here the number of grasses is more than number of grasshoppers. The number of grasshoppers is more than number of frogs. The number of frogs is more than number of snakes, and number of snakes is more than the number of hawks. So higher the trophic level, lower is the number of individuals. Or lower the level of a trophic level, higher will be number of individuals. See, the 1000 grasses may support about 200 grasshoppers. 200 grasshoppers can support about 50 frogs. 50 frogs can support about 20 snakes, and 20 snakes can support to only 5 hawk. So there are 100 grasses in an ecosystem. There is a survival of only about if there are 1000 grasses in an ecosystem, there is a survival of only about 200 grasshoppers. If there are 1000 grasshoppers, they will feed an entire plant one day only. Next day they are not able to have food from that grass. Then if there are 200 grasshoppers, only 50 frogs can survive by eating those grasshoppers. And if there are 50 frogs, only 20 snakes, like that. This is only simple example I am going to give here. Number of grasses, number of producers will be always more in all kinds of ecosystem. All kinds of ecosystem. But some exceptions are there, like huge banyan tree will support a large number of small birds, and those support again a large number of parasites. Again, parasites will support large number of hyper parasites, like that. Some exceptions are there, but in all common ecosystems we find more number of producers than the consumers. and number of top carnivorous animals is always less. Then these food chains are of different types. If it is a forest, we find trees as a producers, and trees are dependents of some what you call as birds, and these birds are eaten by the larger predatory birds. If it is a pond ecosystem, phytoplanktons are the producers. Phytoplanktons are nothing but floating organisms. These float on the surface of water, act as the producers. Phytoplanktons. These phytoplanktons are eaten by the zooplanktons. Zooplanktons are eaten by the fishes. I can say small fishes. Small fishes are eaten by the large fishes. Large fishes. Like that, food chain in aquatic ecosystem will continue. Starts from the phytoplanktons, then zooplankton, then the fishes, then the large fishes. All these series of food chains are not always constant, and these birds are not always feeding on the same tree, and these predatory birds like hawk or eagle always not feeding on the birds. Sometimes they feed on the other animals also. And phytoplanktons, zooplanktons are not dependent directly. Sometimes zooplanktons are feed on the what call the leaves of other plants also. Like that, these food chains are not always constant. Food chains are not always remains as it is. They will change. The species of the prey species of the one or animal will be changed periodically. So in this change, what happens? They create one more concept called the food web. Number of food chains together create a network. That network is called as a food web. So here, what is this food web? Food web is a network of food chains. Large number of food chains will form a network, and that network of food chains is called as a food web. So this food web will be differ in all kinds of ecosystems. It is not constant in all ecosystems. Remaining concept of this food web and our other human issues will be discussed in next class.